It is a month since the Lord God called our brother Wenceslaus Anthony and showed himself. Today, after a month, we are gathered in this beautiful church, which is so dear to him, especially in celebrating the Mother Teresa Interfaith Gathering, to pray for the repose of his soul, and also to pray for the bereaved members of the family, Susan, Sneha, and Angus. And I wish to welcome all of you to this holy mass on behalf of the family, and on your behalf, I assure the family our prayers and support that the Lord may journey with them and that the Lord may grant eternal rest and to Wenceslaus Anthony. With these few words, I kindly request Bishop Patrick Danoff, our Bishop of Auckland, to begin the Holy Mass.
Thank you, Father Matthew. Let us sign ourselves with the cross. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
As we all prepare now to celebrate these sacred mysteries, carrying our brother Wenceslaus in our hearts, we pause as we always do to reflect on our own lives and to ask forgiveness for our failings.
No, then, mercy.
On us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, whose nature is always to forgive and to show mercy, we humbly implore you for your servant Wenceslaus, whom you have called to journey to you. And since he hoped and believed in you, grant that he may be led to our true homeland to delight in its everlasting joys. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God for ever and ever.
Amen.
First reading is a reading from the book of wisdom, chapter 3, verses 1 to 9. But the souls of the righteous are in the hand of God, and no torment will ever touch them. In the eyes of the foolish, they may seem to have died, and their departure was thought to be a disaster. And they are going from us to be their destruction, but they are at peace. For though in the sight of others they are punished, their hope is full of immortality. Having been disciplined a little, they will receive great good, because God tested them and found them worthy of himself. Like gold in the furnace, he tried them, and like a sacrificial burnt offering, he accepted them. At the time of their visitation, they will shine forth and will run like sparks through the stubble. They will govern nations and rule over people. And the Lord will reign over them forever. Those who trust in him will understand truth, and the faithful will abide with him in love, because grace and mercy are upon his holy ones, and he watches over his elect. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My shepherd is the Lord, there is nothing I shall need. Fresh and green are the pastures where he leads. My shepherd is the Lord, there is nothing I shall need. Fresh and green are the pastures where he leads.
If we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from death, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. It is Christ Jesus who died, who was raised, and is at the right hand of God, and who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardships or distress, or persecution or famine, or nakedness or peril or sword? For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Kindly arise for the gospel affirmation.
I know that
the first thing Wenceslaus would want me to do this evening would be to thank you all for being here. But as I look out at all of you, I was just thinking, he would be so thrilled to see you all here. The former Governor General, Sir Anand Satyanand, has asked me to convey his apologies for not being here tonight. And I thought, that's typical of Wenceslaus. He had friends in high places. Sir Anand Satyanand, Pope John Paul II, Mother Teresa of Calcutta, Sir John Key, and you and me. And I was just thinking, looking here this evening, I thought, Wenceslaus would probably be able to go from person to person to person to person and greet us all by name. That was what he was like. That was his great gift of friendship. And over the past month, we've all had the chance to reflect on the gift that Wenceslaus was to us, to reflect on our memory of this beautiful man and all that he meant to us personally, quite apart from what he meant to New Zealand, to the world. When we celebrate the liturgy like this, we bring all our personal little memories and we sit and we reflect on ancient sacred memories that are preserved for us in the sacred scriptures. And all of these memories tell us that the best is yet to come, that there's more to life than this life. The Book of Wisdom, the souls of the just are in the hands of God. The beautiful Psalm of David, the Lord is my shepherd, no matter what happens, the Lord is my shepherd. St. Paul tells us that nothing can separate us from the love of God. Nothing. Not even death itself. Martha professes in the Gospel her faith in Jesus, the one, the Saviour who was to come into the world. This faith, Wenceslaus shared, and Wenceslaus believed with all his heart. And so as we gather this evening, we bring our little memories, and in the light of the beautiful, ancient, sacred memories that tell us who we are, where we've come from, and where we're going, we pray for the repose of his soul. I'm not saying any more right now because a lot of people are going to be sharing their memories of Wenceslaus, and Sneha said everyone's to speak for no longer than 3 minutes. She said, except for her, and she's got a right to speak for a little bit longer. You can have 4 minutes. But we gather to honour a man whom we loved, whom God loved, and who loved God with all his heart. And so as the liturgy continues, we pray that God will grant him the reward of all his goodness, all his labours, all the work he did for so many people, not just in New Zealand or in India, but in so many other places. Eternal rest grant to him, O Lord, and in the place of light shine upon him, and he rest in peace. I invite you now to stand for the prayers of the faithful. Let us now with living faith present our petitions to the Father.
In baptism, Wenceslaus Anthony was given the pledge of eternal life. May he now be admitted to the company of the saints. Lord, in your mercy, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Our brother Wency ate the body of Christ, which is the bread of life. May he be raised up on the last day. Lord, in your mercy, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Many friends and family everlasting home with your Son. Lord, in your mercy, hear us.
Lord, hear us.
We pray for the family and friends of Wency, especially for Susan, Sneha, and Akash, who seek comfort and consolation. Heal their pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that come from grief. Lord, in your mercy, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for our brother Wency. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your Son's coming. Lord, in your mercy, hear us.
Lord, in your mercy, hear us.
Almighty and ever-loving God, we offer all our prayers, the prayers we each carry in our own hearts too. We offer them to you with trust and confidence through Christ our Lord.
Amen. An eternal dwelling
is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God above. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name.
He was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion. He took bread, and giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this all of you and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this all of you and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
Through him and with him.
Face is before me. be measured.
Dear Mrs. Anthony, Sneha, Akash, distinguished guests, my parliamentary colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, we are gathered to celebrate the life of a very good friend who we always was full of bubbles and joy, Wenceslaus, as we used to call him. May I start by quoting the scripture, "Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercy and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all afflictions." I remember meeting Wenceslaus when I arrived in New Zealand 17 years ago and had very close association with him, both professionally and personally. Wenceslaus always had a smile on his face that reiterated the glory of God. He was an example of true servant of Lord, always humble and unfailing his Savior in the work that he did. His service to the Catholic community in Auckland is well documented and respected. As St. Paul said to the testimony in the Bible, I have fought the good fight. I have finished with the race. I have kept the faith. This can also be said for Wency. He showed the love of God through his family, you, Susan, and the children. He often talked about the good family times and was always concerned about Sneha and Akash. I remember Akash and my son were together in Christchurch, and he always used to make a point when he visited Christchurch. He also saw my son and asked if he needed any assistance. That kind of person he was. And he never told me this thing, but my son recently, when we were discussing his loss, he mentioned, Papa, whenever Uncle came to Christchurch, he always used to make a point to see me. I remember at the time when we were at a function or a meeting, he would call your mom and ask if she had dinner or if kids reached home and how your cricket game was, Akash. He always fought for to make New Zealand a secular and tolerant place. We know through his Mother Teresa annual function, where people from all faith came and celebrated diversity and tolerance in New Zealand right here in this building. And we know that he finished a good race. Having visited the Holy Land and to leave us to be on the right hand side of the Lord in the land of his forefathers, what a privilege life and calling it is. As the Bible says in the book of Revelation, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and the death shall no more, neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. Susan, Sneha, Akash, on behalf of Irvinder and my family, Prime Minister, and in particular, Honorable Todd McLean, to whom I did talk this morning, and the National Party, I pass the condolences, and we pray for God's hand to be upon you, to protect you and be a father to the fatherless and a husband to the widow. As the Bible says, Wency, you will be missed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Patrick. May I request Michael Wood? I first acknowledge Susan, Sneha, Akash, Bishop Patrick Dunn, our parliamentary colleagues, and the other distinguished guests who have turned out here tonight. It's a real honour that we're able to farewell Wenceslaus here in Mount Nostal, and it was wonderful to hear before that this is a place that has a special connection to Wenceslaus and his work. In my family, my extended family, I am reasonably regularly called upon to speak at funerals and memorials, and one of the things I make a point of doing is to think very carefully about the words that I use. I don't think one at these occasions can be trite, can exaggerate, or can speak anything other than the truth about a person. And so I say what I'm about to say very deliberately. Wenceslaus Anthony was not just a good man, he was a great man. He was a person who was successful in his life, who had a wonderful family that he cherished, who did well in business and rose to a leadership position within our community. Those things were the things that made him great. What made him great is that he achieved that success, but he then chose not to hoard that success to himself. He chose to give back. And in the 20 or so years that Wenceslaus was here in New Zealand, he made an immense contribution to our communities and to our country. He often acted as a critical link between his old country and his new country. He served on trade delegations of both national and Labour governments. He was the first Indian-born chair of the India-New Zealand Business Council. He sat on multiple advisory boards and governance positions. And I know that he was someone who, within the community, people just went to for help and advice when they needed his wisdom. And we also, of course, know that he chaired the Mother Teresa Interfaith Committee, and that was a role that was very special to him. In all of these ways, I think that Wenceslaus was a model of servant leadership. He rose to a position of saying that for me and others across a range of political parties. One other thing I'll say, I've never been able to say this at any of those other funerals or memorials I've spoken to. Never heard anyone speak a bad word about Wenceslaus. And so as we farewell and mourn the loss of a friend and a brother, we also celebrate a life of giving and of love. And what I hope we can do after tonight's gathering is to take forward with us the spirit of giving that defined this very great man. Wenceslaus, our friend and our brother, you lived well, you gave much, you are well loved, and you rest in the arms of our loving Father in whom you had faith. Go well.
Thank you, Mike. May I request to Mr. Rao Dillon on behalf of India New Zealand Business House.
Picking up on what Bishop Patrick Dunn said, the Wenceslaus had influence over India, New Zealand, and there was another country which he had great influence over, and that was Sri Lanka. I would share a little story. As someone earlier said, that he's been accompanying the Prime Minister on many different trips. I had the good fortune of being along with them on a couple of trips. And on a trip when he was in Sri Lanka, and bureaucrats being bureaucrats, there was a dinner organized with the Right Honourable Sir John Key and the Prime Minister of Sri Lanka. And the bureaucrats did not include Wenceslaus in that dinner list. And the Prime Minister of Sri Lanka put hold of the entire thing and sent a helicopter to fetch Wenceslaus. And everybody was in a flurry. And even Sir John Key had to wait till Wenceslaus came back. So that was his influence across different countries. So we've got a lot of stories to tell. I'm aware of Sneha only give us a couple of minutes, so I'll try and do justice with that. Again, in line with this international thing, I have a little message on behalf of the Government of India, which was sent to me in writing by His Excellency Sri Sanjeev Kohli, the High Commissioner of India. And he's written some very personalized words about him, which I'm going to read. Our friend Wenceslaus was a living example of the core message from the Bible. He was generous, kind, and compassionate. He made enduring friendships and left a lasting impression on people he dealt with. His passing away is a major loss to the community and a personal loss to me. I was not in a position to come to Auckland, but my thoughts and prayers continue to remain with his family. Losing a loved one is never easy. Taking forward his message of interfaith unity and mutual respect, as well as continuing to draw inspiration from his passion for serving the community, will be a best tribute to him. So that was the message of the High Commissioner of India. I would like to say a few words about him. I had the good fortune of working with him for about a decade on the Indian New Zealand Business Council. He brought a new energy to the whole thing, and he will be sorely missed in many different organizations he chaired and led, including the New Zealand India Research Institute at the Victoria University. And as you know, that today we are gathered to pay tributes to a man who has touched and positively influenced thousands of lives around the world. And this started with his family. Again, a little story he once told me. And that's the values he got from his father and his family. That he once told me that when his father retired from a banking job, on the last day, he brought along with him 5 homeless children because he said, I am free now, so I'm going to look after them. So that was the good karma of his father, which Wenceslaus carried and, you know, continued to be such an exceptional human being. And on top of that, he had the good fortune of being associated with Mother Teresa. And I came into contact with this extraordinary personality about, you know, 12 or 13 years ago. And I still remember the first day when he came to my office and we sat and had a cup of coffee together. And after that, he struck a very cordial note and a friendship blossomed. And in his words, we shared the same ethics and values. And we started working very closely together for a cause, very close to both of our hearts, which was the New Zealand-India relationship. And his selfless service to this cause saw him working late hours. Many a time, I would get an email from him at 1 a.m. or 2 a.m. because he'd be up all night calling back India, talking to different ministers and officials because of the time difference. And that was his, you know, commitment to the cause. And for this, he was rightly honored by the, you know, the government of the day by giving him MNZM for his input to the MNZM relationship. And I have a very, very personal memory of that award as well. Because as you know, that you can only take a limited number of people when you go to the Governor General. So along with his family, myself and a very dear friend, Steve D'Souza, who has printed these nice copies for us today, had a good chance of accompanying him during a very, very special moment. And later on, so I've got some very, very good memories. So later on, when he got the Papal Award, at that time also, he wanted me on the stage with him. And he said, you're going to be the only other person other than the family and the priests who are going to be there. And that was a very, very humbling experience. And I told him I'm probably not up to that, but he insisted on that. And that day also, I had a lump in my throat. And I'm sharing the same feeling today. And I can even feel him around all of us today. And he had a heavenly aura. So whenever he was with you, you felt a very different sense of calmness. So that was something very special in that person. And I've discussed with my other colleagues at IZBC, and everybody felt that. They said, yes, now when we look back, when he was with you, sitting in the room or standing beside you, and you had a very good feeling. And you felt safe, you felt calm, and, you know, he definitely had a holy presence, and, you know, and he loved one quote, which he often used to say, that you are a pencil in the hands of God. And he lived that in every moment of his life. And that's why now we call him man of God, as he was also a man of faith, and he incessantly prayed for everyone, not only just his family, for everyone, all of his friends. And his words still resonate very clearly in my ears, as he used to always tell that he's been praying for his family and for everyone. And I will stay forever indebted to God for making me experience such a pure form of friendship, which I actually never experienced before I met him. And I think I never will after him, because he was such a genuine, unique, and pure person. And there are many of those people like him in this world. And I genuinely lost a friend, and even more sad part is that I'm not going to find somebody, you know, as holy and as genuine as him. So that loss is going to be permanent. And I'm also going to carry a guilt that maybe I could not love him back enough, or as much as he loved me. So I have a message for you all. Please value your friendships and your relationships, and shower them with all your love, and make your love overflow, as you never know when God will take the opportunity away from you. And I will finish with a quote from Mother Teresa: spread love everywhere you go, let no one ever come to you without living happy. May His Lord Jesus rest His soul in eternal peace, and may God grant Susan, Sneha, and Akash strength. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. May I request Mr. Prahlad Gupta Ji, Managing Director, Bank of Baroda.
Mr. President, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I joined Bank of Baroda, New Zealand, 3 years back, and since then I am in touch with Mr. Wenceslaus. In these 3 years we became very good friends, and when I joined he was director of Bank of Baroda, and since last year, 2016, he became chair of the board. He was sharing always that his father always wanted that he has to join bank, but he could not join bank. But to fulfill his father's dream, he associated with Bank of Baroda as director and then became chairman. He was a very kind-hearted man of principles with strong belief in good corporate governance, and we always shared official and personal matters during meetings, after the meetings. Every month we had, besides board meeting, we were having one meeting, and whenever he comes to branch, so many people were waiting for him, so many people were taking guidance from him. I always asking him, from where you got this energy? He was always helping people. I never saw in my life who is helping and helping without any expectation. Mr. Anthony was a charismatic personality and multi-dimensional and multi-faceted skill set. His aura and atmosphere he created around while meeting staff members of our bank and customers was beyond our imaginations. The best part was that he always preferred to go and meet every staff and every customer who was at that time in the banking hall. And he was asking whether you are satisfied with Bank of Baroda. This is his greatness as a chairman, he was going to every person. In two sense, he was a majestic personality, and we were fortunate enough that we had worked closely with him and learned a lot, which will be a lifelong treasure for all of us. He always believed in developing personal rapport with people and helping them out. I will always remember Mr. Wenceslaus and his contribution to Bank of Baroda Limited for good leadership, and he introduced a good corporate governance and so many systems. I and the entire team Bank of Baroda pray for the rest of his soul in peace, and my heartfelt condolences to family Susan, Sneha and Akash. Lastly, I will say, may the blessings of love be upon you, may its peace abide with you, may its essence illuminate your heart now and forevermore, now and forevermore.
Thank you, Mr. Gupta. Now I request Lindsay to come.
Seems like a very privilege that you asked me to speak tonight, and thoughts and prayers to you and to Sneha and Akash. And I think I'm probably speaking in a way on behalf of the Auckland Diocese, because it was through working with Wency, we always affectionately called him Wency, other than Wenceslaus, that I came to know him so well. He served in a number of capacities in the diocese. He was a valued member of our Catholic Caring Foundation, that's the Bishop's umbrella charitable organization. He founded, as you've heard already, the Mother Teresa Interfaith Committee, Mother Saint Mother Teresa of Calcutta. And we, the annual event that we've had for about 6 years, most of them, I think five of them, were held in the Spirit Church, which he was, as you've heard already, so very fond of. And he honoured her, he worked with her, as many of you know, and he really honoured her and wanted to continue to have her legacy honoured by all of us, people of all faiths, with whom she worked in all those many years. I think it was Peter who said earlier about servant leadership. I had that in my little notes here too. Wency exercised leadership. He was a born leader, I believe, with great energy and determination. Yet at the same time, he was a model of servant leadership, exercised in the service of God and the people with whom he lived and worked. He was prayerful, he was gracious, and above all, deeply committed to giving of his best and drawing the best out in others. And I think all of us know that. We've all experienced that, that he has drawn us often out of ourselves and often challenged us to sort of move a little bit beyond where we were. He was a man, this is something that I always think of, when I think of Wency, I think he was a man of great courtesy. And when I think of that, I'm reminded of a poem by one of our great Catholic writers of 100 years ago, Hilaire Belloc, who wrote a poem about courtesy. And one of the stanzas in this poem goes, "Of courtesy, it is much less than courage of heart or holiness. Yet in my walk, it seems to me that the grace of God is in courtesy." And I believe that's very much how I sort of remember Wency. I believe that the grace of God was in Wency in all that he did. And I believe that he is now graced with God in the fullness of his love and his life. Thank you.
Thank you, Wency. I request Mr. Venkatraman to come.
Your Royal Majesty, my dearest brother Wenceslaus, I have left several messages since July 22, hoping that you would, as you've always done in the past 18 years, return my calls. This time, alas, you've neither returned my calls nor returned. Why, Your Royal Majesty? Why this deadly silence? Is it because you're in a place where the line is bad? Or is it because you're in a good place where the bad cannot reach you? Why, my dearest Wenceslaus, why this disquieting quietude? Is this because you're now in a world where there are many others like you, good people, people of integrity, honesty, goodwill, compassion, love for all beings, and most important of all, people of virtue, that you do not want to do anything anymore with these people in a world of sinners and everything that is despised in humans? It's often said that sleep is short death and death is long sleep. Over the past 4 or more weeks, I have been under the belief that you would wake up from your sleep and then spend the next 30 hours talking to me, just to make up for the lost time. Your Royal Majesty, I'm waiting. There are only 2 people in this country who have known you longer than anyone else. Both were with you through your scholastic career in Chennai. One of them, my wife, is not here at this service because she's yet to come to terms with the cruelty of reality. The other is Prince Kumar, who has been inconsolable. And I am perhaps among those privileged few who have known you almost from the time we set foot on this beautiful land together in 1999. And you have never seen me cry so loud, so long. Since the past 18 years, we have shared common values and views to serve those around us, those reaching out to us. Many of them ask, where is Mr. Anthony? He always tells you where he is. To them my reply is, yes, I do know where he is. And for the first time in 18 years, he neither told me where he was going, nor asked me to accompany him. I know that he is in the kingdom of heaven, living as a prince, with God as the Lord. Mortals cannot reach him. There are too many great things that you have done, too many for me to list here, but those in the know of your good thoughts and deeds. I'll just repeat what I used to tell you often. All of us come into this world, not of our choice, but that of someone else. All of us come with a return ticket. We know the destination, but we'll never know when and from where our return will take place. We also know that we bring joy to perhaps 2 or 3 people when we arrive, and bring sorrow to hundreds, if not thousands, when we depart. Your Royal Majesty, I've always called you Royal because you are noble. You were always noble. And I've called you Majesty because that's what you were always happened to me. I'm not a man to give up hope. I shall keep trying to reach you, for I'm sure that I will meet you someday and bring you to speak of how and many others cried and how I would rush to the phone when it rings in the wee hours of the morning and scream, Your Royal Majesty, it's great to hear your voice. Until then, I'll play this message that you're on a journey again and again. Until then, let me address you, Death, though just 4 lines from the great bard, John Donne. Death, be not be proud, though some have called thee mighty and dreadful, for thou art not so. One short sleep past, we wake eternally, and death shall be no more. Death, thou shalt die.
Thank you, Mr. Winkett. Now I request Neha and the family to come to the First and foremost, the reason I did that because there's a huge smile that as you can see my father, and that's what I remember him as, a person who always smiled. No matter how hard it was for me in life, he always had that smile. I firstly want to thank, and I'm fortunate to be here, to be delivering this message to honor as I am his chosen son. I would like to, however, speak on behalf of all my family, especially my dad's brothers and sisters, my cousins from different parts of the world, close family friends, the many different business and church associations he had, the interfaith associations for him, religion was one and universal, and of course all the people present here tonight. He has certainly created a huge impact on my life, and I'm called here to celebrate with you all. For me, Dad was a true and incredible and exceptional person. I mean, words cannot explain the impact he has made on my life. His qualities to love beyond measure, the ability to connect
the poorest to the top of society, spreading his faith through service and the ability to let the unspoken have a voice were few of the many great qualities he had. In the words of St. Mother Teresa, I'm sure she's proud because a lot of the times tonight we've used her voice. She said, do things for people not because of who they are or what they do for you in return, but because of who you are. He surely lived true to this value. For me personally, my father took a very keen interest in me as a kid growing up. At a young age, he always used to enter and participate in my parent-teacher interviews. He used to sit down with his pen and paper, take notes, and always look back once we get home to evaluate and formulate a plan of action to evaluate my weaknesses. In my sporting area, my first few years in New Zealand, my father was a soccer manager with the local Lineager club I played for. He was, as a goalkeeper, he used to tell me, son, defend that goal with all your heart, because if the opposition cannot score, they cannot win. To that very year, our team won the championship, and my father, through all his cheers, the participation my mom made through giving me and my team the best support, we won that championship, and he was so proud. And I still picture till today the photo we had of him standing proud as a soccer manager. Now, this even holds true value to me because my grandfather was a soccer player, and that is something I always cherish. My other love for sport, as has been already mentioned, is my love for cricket. Right throughout my years, playing from school through Avondale College First 11 cricket team, through all the boys who are here, who have been part of that team, understand and value the enormous support my dad has shown us. When I look at my cricket journey, my dad not only told me to take cricket as the only source of a sport with passion which you have to enrage to reach the top, but rather to use that skills you gain through your life and the values. I always believe that he was my sporting hero, despite never taking foot much in the sporting arena, because the qualities of a sportsman he definitely displayed through his life. In my later stages of high school, I used to tell my dad it was a dream to become a pilot. Now, he made a condition to me that I first have to complete a graduation degree in commerce before he will support this passion. Once I graduated from university, he supported me towards my goal on becoming a commercial pilot. I still remember till this day, the very first time we both went together to flight school in North Shore Aero Club. My dad stood with me as we spoke to instructor Daryl Gillett. When he told him, he said, you know, oh, my son wants to be a pilot. Daryl's first day, he said, rightio, let's take him up on a flight. Now, my dad, being my dad, said, no way can my son go on a flight. He has absolutely no knowledge of flight, and I don't want us to be this last. Daryl, however, gave him the comfort, saying that, no, this is what we do in New Zealand, just to see if he has a passion for flying. And if his interest is there, you can continue forward with the rest of his training. Now, the key thing about this was not the fact that I completed the flight, but for the fact that he was up there the whole time saying a rosary and a prayer from the time we took off to the time I came into land. Now, I remember him closing it off by the sign of the cross as I landed. He came down and greeted me with a huge smile and a round of applause of appreciation, like I did all the work, but actually I did not do much. To this very day, I always thank him, my mum, my sister, my extended family, and everyone for giving me the support to be a pilot. Many of you know that aviation is not just a financial strain on a family, but it's something which once you gain, it'll take you to places where you can live your dream and take flight from such a height. I always told my dad, I will make him proud to live to my name. Unfortunately, my name means sky, and I've been honored by this privilege to call it my second home. My CEO, Mr. Tavita, who's here with me, yesterday was in the flight with me coming back from Tonga to New Zealand. One of the things I asked him was, what do you find about my father? Is there any ways you can describe him? He took a moment of silence and he graced it with, he said he's got a warm and loving smile.
and it can be seen from a distance from anywhere. And now, all of us will quickly imagine the smile my dad gave us from every time he greeted you. It was almost a very consistent smile he had for us. I always said to my dad, you know, from every flight here onwards, I am the fortunate one. I am closer to your spirit. We all believe God is up there, so I'm definitely going to see you around a lot more. To my sister, you know, I know the hardships and difficulties you will be facing. We, as much as we are human and we believe in a supreme power, we always want that physical presence, which is why we always dwell on it in this world. We reach out to family, we reach out to friends, we reach out to community every time we are down and out, because to have that inner voice of someone else speak to you when we're down is the greatest comfort one can ask for. However, I tell you, through this last 1 month since my dad passed away, his spirit is living through you. I can see his strength coming upon you. I can see that difference living through your life. You will take time to adjust and appreciate the fact that he's not physically present, but his spirit is living through you on forever. To my mom, I know that you are his life partner for 34 years. My coach told me, you know, you are his life partner. You are someone who is going to be affected the most by this loss. I personally want to give you the reassurance that you are the best wife he could ever ask for, and the soulmate, and the blessings you have given upon him is what I personally think we are all here to come here to celebrate. I believe the honor my dad has received is only because of the backbone and strength that my mom has given him. I always think, you know, behind the scenes, they always say, is a person who supported the person behind along the way. My mom was not just a person who just supported him in his business achievements, in his walk of faith, but gave him that emotional support which every man needs. For me, I can only go on to say that, Mom, you know, I can never fill the shoes that my father has. I'm, of course, your son, and I always will be your son. But all I can say is he's got a connection with you, and you need to speak to it whenever you need to talk to him. I will continue being a son to you, and you can reach out to me, and I will always respect you for the love you have shown me, and we have to honor it till the last days of your life. For me and to my father, I must say that you've given me very little notice of your farewell. And that is what my dad is. He leaves us all with full of surprises. As many of you know, he gives that last phone call when we least expect it. And that is the subtle messages he gives us in this world that reminds us that no medical treatment is enough to stop the will of God. And we tried whatever we could. We spoke, we asked the doctors whatever we can. We were willing to pay that extra mile to take him any hospital in this world, because money is not worth when it comes to the value of life. We tried everything possible, and we think of so many scenarios. I must tell you all, from the bottom of my heart, there is no regret behind his loss, because it is the will of God that is his time to go. We have to accept it, because he's fulfilled his journey in this world. It's time for us to fulfill his by carrying on our legacy. I must end by saying, you know, I want to thank my own father, you know, for everything you have done for me. The memories you have given me will be cherished for the rest of my life. You know, I'm fortunate you have set me on a foundation that I can continue your work in the smallest of ways. As you said, and you can read in the quote, a person A cannot complete what person B can do, but everyone is special in their own rights. I want to say that when you received the papal award, you ended your speech by saying, "This clap is not for you, it's for him." For me, I finally must say, as a congregation here, and myself, my heart is pounding with applause for you, because you have served this world proud. You have served the nation of New Zealand proud. As much as we gave India your final farewell, it's as much of an honor as a New Zealand community to stand up strong and to say we thank you for all the memories you have left us with. For me, it's not a goodbye, Papa, but your final words for me was to see you again. I love you, I miss you, and until we meet again, rest in peace. Wish love.
Thank you, Akash. Let me call Sneha Anthony, please.
I'm the last one, so we're nearly there, and I've been put last because mine's the longest. We're at the end of the service, please join me and my family outside for some refreshments. Just begin by thank you, Bishop Pat, for your presence here today. He's been unwell and he still managed to make it through, so our family really appreciates you making the effort. Bishop, thank you. Father Benedict, for giving us this church today to have the service. To Father Matthew, who is the parish priest at Avondale, where Dad was a big part of the church, and Father Valerian, who both played a big part in organizing today, and to all the priests for being here today. I know Dad always had a very special friendship with the priests. He loved being around them and helping them out. And thank you to everyone that organized today. We wouldn't have been able to put this together without you all. How do I even begin to pay tribute to this amazing man whom I had the privilege and blessing of being able to call my father? I feel like anything I say in such a short time is going to be so inadequate for the incredible person he was, but I will try my best. This person who I called my papa, the first man I have ever loved and who will always have my heart, my protector, my comforter, my prayer warrior, my hero, and the one who bestowed me with unconditional love in all seasons of my life. My doll was his name for me. I can't even begin to explain how close we were, because our relationship was like no other and cannot be explained in words. When I think of him, there are three things that come to mind which defined his life: his faith, his family, and his friends. Matthew chapter 6 verse 33 tells us to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Papa was a man whose whole life was lived for God and others. His faith defined him and shaped everything he did to the very end. I long lost count of the number of church groups he was involved with. His day began and ended with prayer in front of our altar at home. His faith was unwavering, regardless of what life threw at him. He knew he was deeply loved by God no matter what. I once questioned him why God let certain things happen despite us praying. His response was, if we could control everything God did and did not do according to what we want, how is it then faith if we just turn God into a puppet who does what we want? God is then not God anymore. He told me to remember Isaiah 55. God says, my ways are not your ways, and my thoughts are not your thoughts. Just as the heavens are high above earth, so are my ways and thoughts beyond you. This verse was one I held close to me constantly as I stood beside his hospital bed, trying to deal with the shock and grief of what was happening. As we heard today, Papa was someone who was involved in numerous activities. However, he was someone who always put family first. He always said, my first calling is as a husband and a father, and he lived that wholeheartedly until the very end. In a world where the concept of being a good husband and father faces many challenges, he set the bar incredibly high. He had an unending love and devotion to Mum, and always providing for her, supporting her, making sacrifices for her, and remaining faithful to her through good times and bad, while always making their marriage fun and joyful. In this, he showed Akash and me what it means to be the husband who loves his wife as Christ loved the church. When I think of myself, I always wonder how I was so undeservedly blessed and honored to have the title of being your daughter. Wherever I went, my introduction would always be, hi, I'm Sneha, Wenceslaus Anthony's daughter. And people's faces would immediately light up, followed with telling me what an amazing person you are. Being your daughter is a title and badge that I am so, so proud and privileged to have and will continue to wear with honor wherever I go. My childhood years spent riding the bike with you in the streets of India, playing in the parks with you, watching you introduce me proudly to all your friends and people at work, and how you would always be excited to see your doll when you got back from work. As we made our home in New Zealand and I grew up, your constant guidance and wisdom saw me through the different seasons and challenges of my life. Papa, I was so blessed to have a father who revealed to me the truth of my Heavenly Father's love for me. Our relationship was like no other. It was one filled with tremendous love and lots of laughs. You always gave me unconditional love and never-ending support, regardless of where I was or the choices I made. You gave me the courage to pursue my dreams, the freedom to make my own choices and learn from the consequences of my decisions. I knew you would always be there no matter what. When I made mistakes, you would bind up my wounds and help me start again. And when I succeeded, you were my biggest cheerleader from the front line. Can't not mention how one of your favorite pastimes was to wind me up just to get a reaction from me. My 9 years of living in Australia saw me come home so often because I could not go for more than a few weeks without seeing you. Akash would always joke with me saying, enjoy your holiday back in Australia for a couple of weeks before you land up back here again. I'm so thankful I made the decision to move back home to New Zealand. I'm so thankful for the time we got to spend together. We talked a lot about your desire to see me get married. For me, the thought of having to leave you and Mum and move away permanently with someone else was something I could just never imagine myself doing. More importantly, you set the standard by which I would judge every man, and that's a very high standard. In everyone that I came across, I always looked for you and them. Your faith, your huge loving heart, your wisdom, your compassion, your integrity, your generosity, your intelligence, your humor, your fun, your humility, the list could go on. Papa, there is no one in this world that will replace you or love me the way you did. But I pray that you will send me someone who will come close to it. And on that day, you will have the best seat in the house, cheering me on with the angels and the saints. I will always be your doll, and you will forever be the love in my life. Coming to his friends, Papa was someone who had an impact on the life of everyone he met. His friends were something he treasured with all his heart, and they came from all over the world and all different backgrounds. He had this unique ability to relate to every person he came across, regardless of who they were, build long-lasting relationships across the globe, and somehow find time to keep in touch with every single one of them. His favorite evening was getting together with friends, where he was always known as the life of the party, with his singing and his special dance moves, which only he could do. The days following his passing saw numerous tributes being paid to him from all over the world, from dignitaries, family, friends, and even strangers. Every one of them relating a story where he has helped and impacted their life. People have mourned him as they would their own family. Younger people have talked of their pain at losing their second dad. As was said in some of the tributes, he had a way of always making people feel like they were the most important person in the world to him every time he talked to them. One said, "You were the reason why people believed in the goodness of humanity." While he was in the hospital, we could not keep up with the hundreds of calls and messages from all over the world. Despite having left India more than 20 years ago, we were surrounded by a continuous stream of visitors at the hospital there and a packed church for his funeral there, with people flying into Chennai in India from all over, which showed just how he touched the lives of all people. My papa had the biggest heart of anyone I had ever met. He was a giver, someone who went out of his way to help whenever he saw a need, without even being asked, and never expecting anything in return. Whoever needed his help got it, and people were always drawn to him wherever he went. As someone who hugely admired Mother Teresa, he followed her advice. To love is to give till it hurts. He loved everyone. Reading through some of his tributes, I was astounded by the hundreds of people he has helped and impacted throughout his life. Right from being a friend to CEOs and advising them, to looking after the children of those who needed help, to visiting people in prison and giving them hope, and just being a listening ear for those who needed it. He did so much for so many people that I sometimes wondered if he alone was given a special type of day that had more than 24 hours in it. During his life, Papa did not like talking about his achievements. But today, as an extremely proud daughter, I celebrate all that he has achieved. At 42, he took the bold step of migrating to New Zealand while leaving a strong career and network of family and friends behind so Akash and I could have a better life. The struggles of being in a new country and having nothing in the first few years would have caused anyone to give up. But through sheer persistence, hard work and faith, Papa built himself and his business up in a way that only he could. This saw him being awarded numerous awards, including the New Zealand Order of Merit from the Queen, and more recently the Papal Award from Pope Francis, along with being Chairman of the Bank of Baroda New Zealand and lots of senior positions in the Indian New Zealand Business Council and board member and leadership positions and advisory positions in various organizations. Papa, your achievements meant that you spent time in the presence of world leaders, CEOs, and others that the world would call successful and dignitaries. But the beauty of who you were was that who the person was did not matter to you. You related to them the same way you would relate to any other person. You treated every person with the same love and respect and gave them the same time, regardless of who they were. And you would make time to stop and talk to everyone you crossed paths with, because you valued humility greatly and recognized the dignity of every human person as someone created in the image and likeness of God, something that you have instilled very strongly in Akash and me. At this point, I would just like to thank everyone for your love and support during this difficult time in our lives. So many of you have cried with us in your own grief, which showed us just how much my papa was loved. Thank you to those who have visited us with food and offering all our other help. Thank you to my manager and my colleagues at ANZ for their support over the last month and for doing everything they can to make my time at work a bit easier in my time of grief. We request your continued prayers and support as we face the long road ahead of trying to find a new normal in our lives. To Akash, you are the younger brother, and over the last month you have shown such courage in dealing with all that has happened and been such a pillar of strength to me and Mum as you took charge of responsibilities and stayed strong for us while dealing with your own grief. In this I see Papa in you. I am so proud of you, and so is he. To my Mum, you're one of the bravest women I know. Dealing with your own physical pain and a hairline fracture and your own grief, you never left his side at the hospital. Watching your love story together over the last 32 years has been such a privilege. It is truly one that shows us what real love is about. I know this is the hardest time of your life. Everything you have done has always been with him, including working daily in the business with him. You have spent every day with him, and I know you are going to feel lost. Yet you have tried your best to put on a brave face despite your heartbreak to be there for Akash and me. Mum, I applaud you with everything I have. I know it is going to be a difficult road ahead for you, but Papa has instilled in us the importance of being there for each other. And together, the three of us will find a way through the grace of God and with the support of our extended family and friends. Papa, you were a man after God's own heart. Everything you did was always with eternity in mind and wanting to do what pleased God. Going to Israel and the Holy Land was your dream for the last 10 years. You walked the steps of Jesus on earth, and then you walked right into his arms. That you breathed your last, not even a second after you were anointed with the final blessing on your forehead by the priest, shows that God was what your life is truly about. Let us all pray for Papa, that God may be merciful to him, and he may hear the words that he lived all his life for. Well done, good and faithful servant. Come inherit the kingdom prepared for you before the foundations of time. Dad's passing shows us that death truly does come like a thief in the night, and that life is short. Psalm 90 says, make us know the shortness of our lives, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. James chapter 4 tells us, we do not know what tomorrow will bring, for our life is like a mist that appears for a while and then disappears. So just like Dad did, we need to make each day count in how we make a difference in another person's life. As I stand here today, I am still in shock and disbelief, and just keep hoping this is a bad dream. My heart is shattered into a million pieces, Papa. You were everything to me. Watching you in the hospital was heartbreaking, and I do grieve for what I have lost. But as St. Paul tells us in Thessalonians, we do not grieve as those with no hope because of our faith in Christ. We know that Good Friday and death does not have the final word. We know we will have our Easter where we will see him again. You taught Akash and me about the two most important things in life through the cross. The vertical, about always having our relationship with God as our first focus. And the horizontal, our relationships with others. Always loving and helping those around us, including those who are unkind to us. And especially for those who can do nothing for us in return. You told us that as long as we have these two things in place, everything else in life is temporary, that will just come and go. Please watch over me and intercede for me from above. Everything I do from here on will be to make you proud. Live by the values you have taught me and do my best to continue your legacy of helping those in need. You were a natural leader that was somehow able to bring everyone together in all the groups that you led with all different personalities, and always achieve your desired outcome.
while still keeping everyone happy, and that's a real skill. I am so proud of what an amazing 59 years of life you lived. You left no stone unturned. Thank you for all you did for us and all the sacrifices you made. You worked so hard to provide for us and give us a home that was filled with so much love, joy, and happiness. You gave me so much, but the two greatest gifts you gave me were my faith and the feeling of being loved like I have never been loved before. In giving me these two things, you have given me everything. All my decisions were made in consultation with you. Now I have to face the world without my biggest support. My life was always centered around you. You were the nucleus of our family. Every time I had a problem, I never feared because I just knew you were there and it would all be okay. The last card you gave me for my birthday this year, you wrote to me, "My doll, I want you to remember that God's grace is always enough for you, no matter what you are going through."
I know it is going to be a hard road ahead, but I will push through it, remembering what you have told me in that card, trusting that God's mercy is in you every morning, and leaning on the support of those around, knowing that you would want me to keep smiling and making the best of every day. My whole life was centered around you, and I will miss you more than words can express. I will miss your infectious smile, your protection, your love, your wisdom, your strength, your bear hugs, and just being with you in your presence. You were truly one in a million. I love you more than you will ever know. You were the best father in the whole world. And while you have gone too soon, I commend you back into the hands of the one who so generously gave you to us. And I thank him for giving me 32 years with you. When I lived in Australia and would come home for a visit, you would stand at the door with outstretched arms saying, "Welcome home, my doll. And when my time here is done, I hope to see you waiting at that door for me saying, 'Welcome home, my doll.' I look forward to our heavenly reunion and running into your arms once again for all of eternity. I love you. Rest in peace." Please join us outside for just some light refreshments, and Mama and Akash will be there too.
Did you ever know that you're my hero? And everything I would like to be. I can fly higher than any eagle. You are the wind beneath my wings. To go unnoticed, but I've got it all here in my heart. I want you to know I know the truth, that I would be nothing without you. Did you ever you're my hero? You're every
to rise, and I kindly request Bishop Pat to give us a blessing.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our celebration is ended. Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
To thee.